Hey class, welcome back to the lab. In this week's video, we're going to be reviewing the constant head permeability test. And as you can imagine, this test is used to find the permeability coefficient of coarse-grained soils. So primarily sands, some silts, but fine grains, clays, and all that stuff can't use this test. So let's get started. All right, let's review the materials for this lab. First and foremost, the most important thing we have is our permeameter. This is where we're going to be compacting and filling with our sandy soil, and that this is basically how we allow water to flow in through it and measure the permeability of it. So there's two nozzles. We have one on the bottom. This is going to be closed and sealed, and this nozzle at the top. And obviously, there'll be soil samples inside. We have the two pore stones. I'll go over that in more detail here in a second. We also have our soil that we're going to be using. This is a coarse sand. I don't know if it's going to see it, but it looks like, you know, like playground sand or like sandbox sand. So again, this test is used for coarse grain soils only because it has to allow enough flow to be measured at a constant head. A bunch of other little stuff. We have funnel to fill up our permeameters. We have measuring devices, so we need our caliper here to measure the diameter and the length of our soil specimen in our permeameter. We have measuring tape. This is going to be used to measure the heads on our constant head apparatus. Of course, we have our thermometer. Need the thermometer. We have our beaker to measure the volume. We have a spoon. We have a big scoop to scoop the soil in. Paper towels, of course. It'd be a messy lab. And we also need our constant head permeameter, or constant head setup. I reviewed this in more detail in the other video in the little 2D world, so review that and it'll get a lot more clear setup of what we're actually measuring from this apparatus and the values that we need for our report. So of course the other thing that we need for this lab are two scales. So these are high precision scales. We have a large capacity scale. This is going to be used to measure the weight of our permeameter when it's empty and when it's full. And we also have this smaller precision scale. So this is going to be more accurate. What is it at? 0.01 gram. And this is going to be used to measure the mass of the water that we're collecting through the effluent of our permeameter. We'll take that mass and be able to convert that over to volume, knowing the density of water, and that's how we're going to get the V in the constant head permeability equation. So if you're looking at the procedures, the first step is going to be taking the measuring the dry and empty mass of the combination of the permeameter assembly. So this is an important step. We need to know how much this weighs empty before we add any soil into it. So we're assuming that everything in here is completely dry, but we're also going to have to make sure all the necessary components are within our permeameter. So let's talk about it step by step of what actually is inside of this. So of course we have the empty assembly. Looks like this. These are two little ports where you could normally collect or connect a piezo tube, but we have these plugged, so no water is going to be filling out. We have this bottom nozzle here. It's going to let water out of the bottom. And then, of course, with the O-ring on the top, this will be sealed. Kind of hard to get straight. Anyways, this will be sealed. We'll use these little hex nuts to close on the top and create a tight seal, a watertight seal. And then inside we also have our porous stones. So these are going to be sandwiching the soil specimen to make sure that no of the soil particles flow out of our nozzles here. And of course we also need to include the spring. This spring just creates pressure on the top with the soil and the porous stone here, just so again that we have good contact and a consistent volume of a cylinder. right, so now we need to fill our permeameter with our soil. We're going to be doing this in three layers. It doesn't need to be exact, but we want to make sure that it's kind of consistent, and we're going to fill it to roughly about the top. It says 650 grams. You don't really need to know the exact amount, but that's just a good estimate to make sure it's filled up. So we're going to fill it up around to the top, do it in three layers, and between each layer we're going to use our little tamping tool just to compact it and increase the density just a little bit. So we'll go ahead and do that, and then we'll take our dimensions of our diameter, inside diameter, and then the height, which is going to be the length of the soil specimen. Almost forgot, we need to put a porous stone in there first. This is really important, because if we don't have this porous stone here, soil particles are going to be able to flow out and clog the bottom nozzle, and that's not going to be good. So this needs to go in first. Good to go. Okay, now we need to put another porous stone on top because we want it to be sandwiched in between everything. And now we need to make sure that there is no sand along this top little ridge here, because that will, if there is sand, that O-ring won't have a good seal, and then we'll have leaking water out of our permeameter, which would be bad. Permeameter set. We're going to take the mass of this. That's going to be your W2. And then we also need to take the length or the height of this specimen, measure that, and then also the inside diameter. So I didn't show that in the video, but it's important to take the inside diameter because we need to know the volume of the soil specimen for your density and your porosity calculations and all that stuff. Okay, so let's go over the apparatus in a little bit more detail because I know it looks a little confusing with just all the stuff going on here. So there's a lot of wires everywhere, you know, but we have our permeameter right here. That's going to be set up right now. It's set up in the backflow condition. So this tube is coming in here. This is that's going to feed our permeameter. This tube is coming. I probably should color coordinate all these tubes. That's feeding from the bottom of the tank here. This tank is being fed from using this top one here all the way down to our faucet. So this is going to be where the water is coming from, coming up here into this top to the tank right here. Now this tube is important. This is our overflow tank. So again, thinking of an infinity pool, this is that tube that is going to keep the water level right at this line. So obviously the water in needs to match the water, or needs to match or be greater than the water out plus this flow. So it's going to take some time tinking around with the nozzle heels here to make sure we get at a constant elevation. So the goal is for this tube to be filled with water and a constant flow coming out, draining into the sink. So again, first, we're going to set this up in the backflow condition, and this is so we can fully saturate the soil specimen. It's going to be flowing from the bottom up, so it's going to be pushing all the air bubbles up out, and we're going to be running that for about 10 minutes or so, and then we'll do some visual inspection to make sure that the soil is fully saturated. There's no air bubbles or anything. While it's doing that, I'll take the measurements and show you how to take that HZ and the HN value that you need for the equation.
So as it is back saturating, let's go ahead and take the other measurements, the height measurements off of the datum of our table. So these are going to be the head measurements that we need to calculate the permeability coefficient. So again, just to recap, right now it is back saturating. The water is flowing in here. All the valves are open. And we are hopefully pushing out all the little air bubbles that are inside the soil specimen. It's not going to be 100% saturated, but it's going to be close. Usually you'd have to let this run for a lot longer than we're going to be doing in this lab. So keep that in mind when you're writing your lab report. So the thing that we're actually going to be changing is the HN, and that's the height from the table, which again is our datum, to the bottom of the nozzle. So when we're actually running this test, the water is going to be flowing from the top bottom. So the bottom head is going to be right here wherever this nozzle is, letting the effluent flow out. So we'll take this initial one. This one is about 6.25 inches. And again, this is what we're going to be changing though. The HZ, which is not going to be changing, is the height from our table to the infinity pool line. So remember, this is going to be constantly at this head elevation. You'll be able to see, hopefully it's staying there. We can tell by this tube is constantly, letting water out. So it should be at this constant head, constant water level. Okay, so again, table is our datum. We will take this and try to get a good estimate to that line. 43.38 inch. So 43.25. Yeah, 43.25. So a quarter of an inch again. So 43.25 is going to be our HZ, and that's not going to change through the whole experiment. So it's been back saturating now for about 15 minutes. We're going to assume that through this whole process, all the air bubbles have been pushed out. But remember, it's never going to be perfect. But that's just what we're going to have to do. Again, Darcy's law assumes that it's a fully saturated specimen and it's all moving in laminar flow. So these things we're still going to be assuming that is happening. So now we'll switch it over, let it run again for about 15 or 10 more minutes so it can equal out and water flow and flush anything else out. And then we can start taking our measurements at this HN, because we're going to change this HN over time, but we'll take three mass calculations at this HN. So it's had time to level out now for about 2 minutes or so. It seems like the effluent is clear, right? Most part, there's no fines pushing through it. It's staying consistent. So now we are going to start taking measurements of the volume over a certain time period. So again, we'll do 30 seconds. We'll measure the volume of water flowing out of the effluent here of this bottom nozzle over 30 seconds. Now, what I've also already done is taken the empty mass of this, and we're gonna need to make sure that it is completely dry after each time. We're gonna do three trials at this head. So we'll take three measurements of volume over 30 seconds, and then we'll average those. The goal is to have them kind of close. If we see that they're increasing each time, then we need to wait for it to level out. One more thing also we'll do is take the height of this. It should be close to what the original height was. This original L, this will be L1, but it could be a little different because as the water flows through, it might compress and cause some consolidation or some settlement in that soil, and it could lower a little bit. So you'll see an L1 value, that's what this is, and it's different than the L0 value.
have the volume collected over 30 seconds. Make sure all the water is cleaned off and stuff. We'll take the weight of this. This will be the weight of the water for trial 1-1. So 1-1. So we'll do 1-1, 1-2, 1-3. We'll change the head here. We'll change the nozzle. And then we'll have 2-1, 2-2, 2-3. And then change it one more time. 3-3, or 3-1, 3-2, 3-3. So that's where all these numbers are coming from. Okay, so that's it for the constant head permeability test. Now remember, there's two or kind of three like main assumptions and sources of error that you have to deal with here. The first and foremost is being that we aren't losing any head in these small little diameter pipes. So if you've taken like any hydraulics class, you know that there's head loss due to pipes like this, right? Like a small diameter friction within it. So that minor head loss in the pipe we're assuming is negligible, even though there probably is a little bit. So again, the whole assumption here, the head right here at the top of our infinity pool is the same head that is right here at the top of our soil. So all this friction in the pipe there is gonna be neglected, which might not be the case. The other sources of error are, you can see it's leaking just a little bit. We try to get a perfect seal on our permeameter. We use some Vaseline and some grease kind of to get that good seal on the O-ring. It's not gonna be perfect though, of course. So we're assuming that all the flow into our permeameter is flowing out of our permeameter. 100% saturated sample two, we're assuming that might not be the case. The other thing you can see, there's a lot of error just in timing it right. So we're saying that it's 30 seconds exactly when I remove the beaker to find the volume. Of course, it's hard to get it exactly. You'll probably see in the video it was off by like a couple seconds or a millisecond sometime. And that's why we're doing three weights of soil, so three volumes of soil, and then we're taking that average to account for any human error in that case. But this is the constant head permeability test. Only thing left to do now is clean this out, make sure everything's dry, and then generally we would do this again on another sample and then do the whole thing over just to make sure that we can test it at different void ratios and densities, but not in this lab, so you guys are lucky. So any questions at all, let me know. Hope you enjoyed the video and good luck on the lab report.